Aloha.
Aloha.
I'm Rick Clifton. I'm a Court of Appeals judge from Honolulu and a fan of the Chicago Cubs. Currently in year 104 of their quest for a World Series championship and proof that you can resist all efforts at competitive balance. I want to join the other members of the Hawaii delegation in thanking you for coming to our islands for this conference. I see a number of quality Aloha shirts in the crowd, and local merchants urge me to let the rest of you know there's still time to add to your collection. We hope you take home not only the Aloha shirts and other island wear, but the Aloha spirit that makes our islands a wonderful place for a conference like this. We look forward to seeing you at the next conference in Monterey. We also look forward to being able to welcome this conference back to our islands at some point, and we hope the not too distant future. When I was asked by the conference committee to introduce this segment, I sort of asked myself the same question Professor Miller asked. Why am I here? I mean, it's not like the person that you're here to listen to needs a lot of introduction to this crowd. There is some peril in introducing a Supreme Court justice if you're a Court of Appeals judge. After all, they're the ones that grade our papers, and sometimes not all that kindly. And this year in particular, there was the possibility of hostile reporters lurking about. So why me? And I realized it was because they knew that I could take the heat. Those of you who were at our last conference in Sun Valley recall that I served as a mannequin for the equipment worn by smoke jumpers who parachute into forest fires to combat them. So I was ready for it then, but unfortunately the smoke jumpers didn't let me keep that equipment. And America's top model didn't call me afterwards for a new job, so I'm still here. And I learned the real reason they asked me to be here is to try to provide a little bit of insight into the two justices that we expected to have here, because I'd first met each of them many years ago. That is then-Judge Anthony Kennedy. Now, I'm not sure of the year of the photograph, but it was early in his tenure with the Ninth Circuit, and I first met him in 1976. When he was the newest judge on the court, and I was a law clerk for Judge Herbert Choi, the first Ninth Circuit judge from Hawaii and the first Asian American Article III judge. I was here in Honolulu serving as his law clerk, and that time the Ninth Circuit came to Hawaii for oral arguments with one panel a year, and then Judge Kennedy was a member of that panel. I was assigned to be the court crier and timekeeper for the oral arguments that week. But I gotta tell you, oral arguments don't make a great spectator sport if you don't know what the cases are about. And Judge Choi wasn't on the panel, so I didn't know what the cases were about, or I wasn't going to, except that Judge Kennedy realized that, and he went out of his way to ask if I'd be interested in finding out from him each day what that day's calendar was like. And so he spent 5 or 10 minutes each day describing the cases to me and telling me what issues to look out for, which I thought was uncommonly kind and generous, and I appreciate it to this day. As for Justice Alito, who can't be here, I'm asked to extend his regrets, not the least of which because he bought non-refundable tickets for the rest of his family. But he can't be here because his 97-year-old mother has had health problems and did have emergency surgery. I've spoken to his judicial assistant. His mother is still in the hospital but is recovering and is expected to bounce back. But Justice Alito is now in New Jersey rather than Hawaii. What can you do? But I first met Justice Alito when he was Sam Alito in 1968 when we were both college freshmen. We wound up going to college together for 4 years and law school for 3 more and remained friends, although for most of our lives we lived 5,000 miles apart. Now you already know his biography, much as you know Justice Kennedy's biography, but something you might know about him is that being a justice at the Supreme Court was not really his dream job. I mean, it's a good gig and all, and he appreciates the challenge, but if he really had to get his dream job, he would be with the Philadelphia Phillies. Indeed, one of the things that may have caused us to bond is that he is a serious baseball fan and a fan of the Phillies, which when we first met were both, Phillies and Cubs were both historically bad baseball teams. Now, I'll note that the Phillies have won a couple World Series since then. They're in year four, as opposed to our year 104. But despite that, we have remained friends. That picture comes from a fantasy camp that his wife gave him as a Christmas present about 20 years ago. I don't know that if he has any idea that I still have that card, but they gave cards to the campers, and he sent me one, and I kept it. I don't look for it on eBay. I'm still going to keep it. The reality, of course, is that he's now 62 years old, and so his playing career probably would have ended by now, and in a different life, he might have been on the last panel instead of this panel, whatever. We're here to welcome you to the last session, which is our traditional conversation with the justices. Joining Justice Kennedy are, in order from the far side, Andrew Jacobs, who's the chair of the LRCC from Arizona, Judge James Otero from the Central District, Marcia Berzon, my colleague on the Ninth Circuit, and our conference chair, Bankruptcy Judge Laura Taylor from the Southern District. And with that, have at it.
I want to begin by thanking Justice Kennedy for some enormous flexibility. This was not what he had planned on participating in. And I also want to thank the other people up here for packing suits for Maui. Believe me, that's not first on your put in your suitcase list. Judge Berzon has agreed to lead us through this conversation, and I'm going to turn it over to her.
Justice Kennedy, we are all, the four of us, members of the committee that helped plan this conference, and just Judge Clifton talked about grading papers, so maybe we'd like you to grade our paper a little bit. That is, do you have any comments on the conference, any things that you particularly liked, any things that you found particularly helpful in terms of your going back to the court in the fall?
Thank you very much. Good morning. One thing about Sam Alito, we had a very difficult, you know, when the poet wrote that April is the cruelest month for the Supreme Court, he should have said April, May, June. But Sam and I kept our spirits up and our energy up by talking about the excitement of going to Hawaii. He really did want to come and send his best regards. On the plane from San Francisco to Washington, I met an attorney who'd been, is not coming to this conference, he was on business, but he'd been to a number of the conferences. He said, the conference has the best and most worthwhile program of any conference, and that's confirmed, I think, by the splendid program you have. Congratulations, Laura, again. Comments on the panel? We can maybe talk just a little bit about the panels. This last one, Professor Miller said that his father would take him to the Yankees game. My father, we lived in California, had to take depositions in New York, so he took me with him for my first trip to New York. I was 14, and we went to a Yankees game, and we sat down, I think maybe by the first base side, and over us was a railing with another row of seats. And there, it was a hot day, and there was a coat on the railing. And the coat fell off to the fellow, right on the fellow next to me, and he looked at him and said, "Where are the pants?" And I thought a little bit about that when we're doing only half the antitrust law. We get a little way into it. Maybe we should either give him the coat back or get the whole suit. I don't know. But, the Washington Nationals now have a very exciting young player. He's 19 years old, but he argues with the umpires. And one of the announcers told the story when he was playing baseball. He complained to the umpire when the umpire called a strike and he was the batter. And he said, that was really a wide strike. He said, if you think that one's wide, wait till you see the next one. And I thought a little bit about that when you were talking about ethics in the ethics area. But one of the interesting things about the antitrust exemption discussion, labor discussion you just had was, when should the courts wait for Congress and when should they not wait for Congress? And we talked about that, the panel talked about that a little bit with the surveillance case, the GPS case, Jones. And some panel members indicated the courts should weigh in, others indicated the Congress should do so. In a way, what we talk about is a fiction. We say, well, this is for the courts. But if you have a very complicated, very comprehensive act, it was probably enacted with a compromise that was a galaxy of legislators who got together for that vote, but then the galaxy disappears and they'll never be there again. In reality, what we say about some of these complicated statutes is it's not going to change because there's just not the momentum to get through that legislative inertia to make a change. And there are different kinds of statute. Antitrust, NLRB, written in what? Section one, two sentences, section two, and we have an accretion of judicial decisions. That's that kind of statute. Then you have a statute like Sarbanes-Oxley, which I don't know much about because it hasn't come much to the courts at all and not to our court. And that is so detailed that Congress almost warrants that if the act isn't operating quite in the way that it's anticipated, that it will go back year to year and refine it. If it's going to make that kind of a refined statute, that kind of detailed statute, it ought to refine it over time, and it doesn't do that. There's no clear answer. Obviously, there should be an interplay between Congress and the courts as we go back and forth. But I had those thoughts about the panels. Maybe we can talk a little bit more about the racial discrimination panel. But maybe my other colleagues on the panel would comment.
Well, with regard to the question of the court-Congress interaction, which did come up in the last panel, i.e. why doesn't Congress write a new statute? Not only, obviously, are there the political problems, there are also all the drafting problems. And Laura, you mentioned, for example, that the bankruptcy statute from 2005 has severe problems, which will probably never get fixed.
We have sentences without verbs. I mean, it's so it's difficult to not say someone should, we need a scrivener, we don't need a Congress, we need someone just to do some proofing. But one of the things that struck me when I went on the bench was reading decisions and the many, many judges begging Congress to provide clarity. And I think in those cases, the court has. There's been no movement in Congress to fix it. So I think at some point we have to look to the courts to do it, the circuit and the Supreme Court.
Apart from the substance of the panels, and I think this is one of the best conferences I've been to, I was heartened by your words, Justice, at the beginning and the opening ceremony regarding the importance of these conferences and how we're able to sit here, district court judge, Supreme Court justice, having conversations that are important for all of us here, bench and bar.
Well, they are. For instance, there was a suggestion from one of the panel members on the surveillance panel that maybe the Supreme Court should have gone ahead and decided this issue. Right. The issue being whether surveillance of action that is actually available for the public to see, if the public had a GPS, if that's a search. And there was a decision in the Ninth Circuit, a decision in, I think, the Seventh, rather elaborate decision in the district court in that case, in the Court of Appeals, before we heard it. I still think that it would have been a major mistake for the court to go beyond a case which was resolved based on well-settled Fourth Amendment principles. And as I was sitting in the conference, I was thinking, I'm here in this conference. It was about 3 hours, two different panels. And what I learned was just mind-expanding. It was fascinating. Now, if we had decided that case, we would have had a 30-minute argument from one attorney on that point. And we're just not ready. We had some very good opinions in the Court of Appeals, but in my view, not nearly enough. The other thing was, Justice Alito would have liked this discussion because he wrote a very fascinating concurrence. But if you know that there are five justices that are not going to reach the issue, then you're more free in the concurrence and you can make some suggestions that will help courts of appeals and our court in later cases. So that was also a good illustration of judicial dynamics, I thought.
Another topic regarding judicial dynamics has to do with the question of how the Supreme Court is able to or tries to predict the impact of its decisions on lower courts, on prosecutors, on the real world, so to speak, afterwards. And in particular, there were two recent cases as to which it would be interesting to talk for a little while about both the actual impact and how the court is able to find out about that impact. And those are the Iqbal Twombly pleading cases, and the second group are the plea bargaining cases from this last term. Did you think about how these were going to play out, and moreover, how can the lower courts help you learn more about how they play out for the next round of decision making?
Iqbal and Twombly, I think it's fair to say, Judge, expand the powers of the district courts to dismiss an action at the pleading stage rather than going through trial. And we thought that this was a necessary judicial safeguard in order to avoid the costs and expense of litigation that in the end will not present a cause of action that is substantial enough for full resolution. But we don't know how these things work. And you know, the judges on the Court of Appeals know this. You have some choices. You can either just decide the very narrow facts of the case. What do you call it? Spotted calf or spotted cow? Okay. You say this case is decided this way just because of these facts. That doesn't help the system. You're not giving any guidance. On the other hand, you can have some broad general propositions in which case you're probably wrong. And so you try to find the middle ground. And Iqbal and Twombly are cases where we need to learn, and the courts of appeals need to learn more about how they're working out, how the specifics play out in practice. Whether or not they'll work, I'm not sure. And I was wondering whether a district court judge, and Andrew, you could comment on it as well, would feel comfortable in saying, well, now the Court of Appeals has given us Iqbal and Twombly, and we've had them for 3 or 4 years, and this works really very badly in this kind of cases, it's a bad rule, and it works very well in this kind of cases, it's a good rule. Or if the district court would feel that, well, it's perhaps a bit presumptuous for it to comment on how silly or wise the Supreme Court rule was. I just don't know how the courts should handle that.
Post Iqbal and Twombly, the district courts are experiencing just a significant impact in the number of motions to dismiss for failure to state a claim. I embrace the cases because it's an additional tool for me to control and handle litigation. But there is a significant impact. Almost every motion to dismiss now includes the argument that the complaint doesn't meet the heightened pleading standards. In terms of addressing the issue of how it impacts the district court in terms of addressing that issue to the circuit and to the Supreme Court, I would be concerned about whether I should do that. My audience are the lawyers and the parties before me, and I'm trying to explain the decision. But conversations such as this, I think, in our conversations, you're recognizing the impact.
It seems like Daubert that it's kind of elegant in its simplicity. It obviously confers a lot of discretion on the district courts, which will view plausibility in different ways. But like you said, Justice Kennedy, it's very different to say it weeds out prisoner cases or frivolous cases involving allegations of conspiracy in a foreclosure context. And though I'm sure that as practitioners we inundate Judge Otero and the district judges with motions in general business cases, it probably is less apt there.
But and one of the things is sometimes it's the law of unintended consequences. We have a rule to help the district courts, but then we have satellite litigation about that rule. Rule 11 was going to change discovery practice. We found the silver bullet or the magic key, whatever the metaphor is. Well, all of a sudden we had all sorts of litigation involving Rule 11, and we found it wasn't really that cost effective, and the courts had to reach the right balance. And what you say with Iqbal and Twombly is interesting in that regard. Now, you feel bound as an attorney that you have to make the Twombly-Iqbal motion.
We do, because there is a wide variation as to what judges determine to be plausible, and we don't wish to be overzealous, obviously, but oftentimes complaints lacking factual specificity are going to be found implausible, where someone else looking at it might find it plausible. So it does place an additional burden on us to make sure we don't inundate the courts, but that we properly advocate.
You had mentioned also that you thought the plea bargaining cases from last year were going to require some rethinking of the way that the pleas were done in the first place.
The plea bargaining case, there were two cases, one we call Leflar, the other Fry. And in these cases, criminal cases, the plea bargain process didn't work very well because the attorney committed IAC, inadequate assistance of counsel. In one, I forget the exact facts, but the prosecution made a terrific plea bargain offer and said this is good for until a given date, October 1st. And the attorney just forgot to tell his client about it. The offer expired and the client got it, I think, at least three times. The client did have a trial, a jury, full jury trial. So we know that he was guilty after a jury, but the sentence was at least three times as great as I recall. And then the other was where the attorney told the client, oh, well, you have a terrific argument to the jury you're not guilty of the homicide because you don't have this intent. And it was just wrong under the state law. And so that plea bargain dropped. Again, he was found guilty. And my colleagues in dissent said, well, once you have the gold standard, the jury trial, doesn't that expunge any errors that happened before? And how can the courts begin to get into the plea bargain process? The majority of the court thought that, well, plea bargains are what, 90%+ of criminal dispositions, state and federal, are in the plea bargain system. And if we say that we're just closing our eyes to inadequate assistance of counsel there, it's just unrealistic. Now, how is this gonna play out? What's the district judge supposed to do when he or she knows that there's, or the state judge, because it applies to state courts too, when there's a plea bargain? Does that judge have absolutely really the duty to protect the prosecutor's office and the court system from collateral litigation later by asking about the negotiations? And Rule 11C of the Federal Rules of Criminal Procedure, I think it's 11C, all but tell the district judge, stay out of this. So now you have a Supreme Court decision that I think is in somewhat conflict with the rules. I don't know if you've been stumbling over this or not, but we gave this problem to you. Work it out.
In Frey, I think you pointed out what district court judges recognize, in that our system of criminal justice is a system of pleas and not so much trials. And district court judges are not part of the plea bargaining process. We're prohibited from being involved in that process. So this case is going to have to be examined closely by district court judges and trial court judges on the state side to see what else we should be doing.
Now some states have rules that all discussions and negotiations have to be disclosed on the record. And then that would give some assurance that the client knows what they were.
Justice Kennedy, if Judge Otero is dealing with this issue, if the district judges are dealing with this issue, how can they present it? I mean, Judge Otero and I were speaking, and he's so busy, you know, just trying to get the work of the court done. How do you convey this information to the Court of Appeal, to the Supreme Court, in the decisions that the district judges are making? Is it a wise investment of their time and talents?
Yeah, I'm puzzled about that. That goes back to the last question. Should a district judge take the time and say, look at Court of Appeals and Supreme Court, I've had your rule for 3 years, here's the problem that's caused, fix it. Well, the judge said his job is to decide the case. His lawyers aren't interested in writing some essay on to the Court of Appeals, it's because you have to decide the case.
I'm not sure that the Circuit Conference is designed for that kind of interchange. It helps. Legislative hearings do. But can you have a legislative hearing on a constitutional rule? Now, you can have legislative hearings about procedural rules to implement the constitutional rule. And so maybe that's, again, where the legislature and the courts and the bar, with the comments from the Academy, ought to be more responsive to each other, really.
But one of the things I'm hearing here is a question of timing. That is, is it useful to the Supreme Court to have this information before they make the decision in the first place, or afterwards? What you were saying with regard to Jones is we slow up in order to let the information develop, both in terms of academic information and also conferences like this and also lower courts. But at other times, it appears that there's not that timing, slowdown timing doesn't operate, and it's a post hoc sort of fix-up operation once you see how it plays out.
You can put the problem in highlighted form with Roe versus Wade. Roe versus Wade came upon an unsuspecting populace where there had been no civic debate on this subject. Legislators hadn't been involved in it, public hadn't been involved in it, it came out of the blue. And Ruth Ginsburg, Justice Ginsburg, once made a comment. She said, it's too bad that we hadn't had that public dialogue so that the courts would have been better informed. She was later criticized for it, but she was right in saying that the grounds for decision would have been much stronger if there had been a public dialogue so that the court could have referenced that in its decisions. On the other hand, if you see an injustice before your very eyes, are you going to say, well, I'm going to wait so the court knows more? That's not your judicial oath to resolve the case before you if there's an injustice. So that's the tension.
Was there anything about the race and sentencing panel yesterday that brought up issues of this kind? That is, there was a set of feedback to all of us, and the question is, what do any of us, the district judges, the courts of appeals, the prosecutors, and the Supreme Court, do, if anything, in regard to this sort of set of statistics and information and that we've learned and that other people could learn as well? Do we wait? Obviously, we wait for cases, but then what? What do we do with it?
That panel was extremely interesting from a district court perspective, but at the same time, I see it every day. I see the disparate impact on minorities in terms of sentencing every day. And what's frustrating is seeing U.S. attorneys or having U.S. attorneys coming into court arguing for a guideline sentence, because it's easy to do that. There's protection in that. You're not making a mistake. I think it's up to district court judges to use their discretion to consider a number of issues in imposing a sentence that may be well below the guidelines, if appropriate. There are cases where sentences above the guidelines are appropriate.
I thought it was a fascinating, look at the volatile mix you had. Racial discrimination, sentencing, corrections, burden on our public welfare system. And it's a powerful panel because the genesis of probably 80% of prejudice is simply ignorance and indifference. We don't know. When I was in high school when Brown versus Board of Education was decided, our family knew Earl Warren very well. My father said, who was a lawyer, said, this is a great decision. I said, there's going to be no more racial discrimination anymore. It's over. And I hope my sister knows this because she's going to be either a secretary or a nurse. And I was a person, I think, of generally goodwill, absent malice. I just didn't know that The hardest thing is to understand the present. When we were in Thailand, because I thought it was important, the State Department thought it was important to have a conference of the ASEAN judges. And Cliff Wallace was part of the conference. And we had the judges from the ASEAN nations in Thailand scheduled for, I think, January 15th. But on December 31st, they had the tsunami. I said, well, what are we going to do? We have judges sitting around talking about their low pay, and we've got this tsunami problem, and about very serious problems of underpaid judges in these countries that are trying to establish the rule of law. And Colin Powell, who was then still Secretary of State, phoned and said, you be sure to have that conference. And I said, well, how can we do this? He said, no, you have this conference. So we did, and Bangkok is about 250 miles north of Phuket. So we did, of course, didn't go there. But I met a Catholic priest, and he, was it Robert Coles, was the Harvard psychiatrist who pioneered this idea where he would give a child a piece of paper and some color crayons to have the child draw pictures to enable him. And this priest had talked to kids 10, 12 years old who'd lost their entire families. And he had them draw the tsunami, which the kid did so they could confront the trauma, and then draw the past, what his family was like, and then draw the future. And the kid, we all know what the future is going to be look like. We're wrong, but we know what it's going to be like. And then he said, draw the present. And it was a blank sheet. The present is one of the hardest things for us to know. And that's true with discrimination. It's happening. Injustice is a matter of, because you don't see something in large part. And I thought this panel was an extremely powerful reminder of the fact that the battle against discrimination has not ended. I think but we have to be very accurate about these things. I thought a wonderful movie was Invictus. It was about Nelson Mandela. But I was really bothered because Invictus is this wonderful poem by Hensley, out of the night that darkens me, black as the pit from soul to soul, I thank whatever gods may be for my unconquerable soul. And that's what Nelson Mandela supposedly cited in his cell. That wasn't right. What he cited was Teddy Roosevelt's Man in the Arena. I would rather fail acting greatly than to be with those cold and timid souls who can know neither victory nor defeat. That's what Mandela actually recited. And when you play with facts like this in our culture, I think you really hurt our heritage. So I wish we could be very more accurate in presenting our heritage and our literature to our young people. But with reference to discrimination, Thurgood Marshall used to say that the battle is never won. I became very close to Thurgood. Here was a man who was a hero, an icon, when I was in high school, and I'm sitting at the same table with the man. But he loves stories, and we became very close. You were clerk for Justice Brennan at the time, before I got there, but you knew Thurgood. And we went to, I sat with him in the movie, the premiere of the movie, and I think it's Morgan Freeman, or that's in the movie, plays Thurgood. And the title was Separate But Equal. And I said, Thurgood, high school students, for generations, are going to think that you wanted Separate But Equal. And it sounds good. Separate But Equal? That sounds pretty good. So I think when we talk about these things, we want a high degree of precision. And it was too late to change the title, but I thought the title was just wrong. I'll tell you one other thing about that. They had a picture of Thurgood's office, and they had a bottle of bourbon on the office table for the lawyers were discussing it, you know, the case at night. And I don't know, Jim Beam or whatever you call him. And Thurgood was very upset about that. He said, "We never had liquor in the office." And I said, "Oh, Thurgood, then nobody will notice." He said, "My friends will notice." So I thought a lot of them, but those memories came up when I heard that panel.
We had an interesting conversation yesterday when we were preparing this about law school education and the questions of whether there should be some substantial revision about whether there should not be a third year of law school, whether there should be more clinical education, whether there should be an articling program, which apparently several states are now exploring for requiring another year.
What program?
Articling, in other words, or apprenticing, a year after law school. To get skills, all of which is evolving partly from the enormous debt load of law students and partly from the economics of law practice, such that practitioners really can't do, don't do, the firms don't do the training of young lawyers that they used to do. So Justice Kennedy had some interesting thoughts about that, and I wonder if he'd share them.
Well, I really defer to the people that are a lot closer to the practice than I am as to what we do. The charter was given to the law schools by one of the founding partners of Cravath, Swain, and Moore in about the 20s. And it told the law faculties, don't worry about the fact that you don't know how to practice. You teach the law in this academic way. Give our students the language of the law that they can have for the rest of their careers. And this is the language we talk with each other. This is a great resource. It's the envy of the rest of the world. And then we will teach them how to practice. This is the big firm model. Well, now, as I understand it, and you all would know better than I, that the young man or woman comes out of the law school with this tremendous student debt. I was at a law school, I don't know, 10 years, 15 years ago, and I had breakfast with the students. I wanted to show how withered I was. I said, "Oh, you must have a big student loan, maybe $10,000. Well, of course, they roared with laughter. But they come out packing these huge student loans, and then they go to the law firms, and Andrew, you could verify, what I hear is the clients will say, "We're not going to pay $500 an hour for this young person." And so you've got that problem.
It's true, and as people say, law firms are less able to put the newest students to use, although I think that can be a bit overstated. There's less call for perhaps lawyers in the civil bar, at least across the board. But the crushing debt burden is really something that calls for a need to reform the system.
Justice Kennedy, one of the things you mentioned when we were talking, I've been thinking about, is the model for judicial education. There's a different model in Europe, for example, in some countries where you actually train to be a judge. You make that election at a very early point in time. And I think I've had an 18-year-old from Russia who is getting ready to go to school to be a judge. My law school, Duke, just started a graduate program for judicial education. What do you think about those sorts of?
Well, it's what Marcia was talking about earlier, this articled program. The Goldberg versus Kelly was decided in the late 60s, maybe 1970. And the Supreme Court of the United States said, "Well, you can't take away any welfare or pension benefits unless you have a hearing." And the state of California said, "Well, what are we going to do? We need 200 hearing examiners." So Dorothy Nelson may remember, at McGeorge, we talked about it, and we talked to some of the other law schools. And we went to the governor and said, "How would you like to have 200 hearing examiners 6 weeks from now, and they're free?" just pay their airfare. And it was the law students. And the law students loved it. They said, Judge, good morning, Judge, good morning, Judge. they were terrific, and they went all over the state to comply with Goldberg versus Kelly until the state of California had the time and the resources to implement it, and it worked splendidly. These young people, of course, are closer to the real world than a lot of judges are anyway, and so that was an example of where it really worked. I hadn't thought about that, and I was wondering maybe law schools ought to think more about assisting pro ses in the drafting of comprehensible pleadings and so forth.
Actually,
so there's a lot of things you can think about.
In our court, when in immigration cases in particular, many of the law schools have immigration clinics, and when they do a number of cases every year, and uniformly they are better than 95% of the immigration lawyers who represent petitioners in our court. They do an absolutely amazing job. Of course, they have the time to put in that is not economic for situations in which basically poor people are paying lawyers not very much and usually often not very good lawyers, but they really do a remarkable job in the immigration clinics.
Well, the clinics, I assume they're coming to the courts of appeals. They come to the Supreme Court. And they do marvelous work. The Stanford Clinic, Jeff Fisher, and one of our great former circuit judges is now involved in, and they do marvelous work. Now, and you know, if you've taught, the student will say, I learned more from that clinic going into the police court than I learned in law school. The problem is that they weren't in law school. So there's a trade-off here. But I sense a watershed moment for law school education. And I would hate us to be like the rest of the world, we mentioned it in the opening session, where we don't have graduate law schools. The young judges in Europe, as you correctly say, go through the career track. They go into the civil service, and they're going to be judges the rest of their lives. I taught at the School for Judicial Education in the Netherlands, and there was a young woman, I would think maybe in her early 30s. I always miss that calculus when I look at people, but. I taught there for 2 days, and I took questions, and she raised her hand on the second day. And she said, how can I be a good judge when I know so little because of my age concerning the world around me? And the place was quiet as if I had to answer this question. And I said, if you always ask yourself that question, you'll be a good judge. But that's their system. But the price they pay, as we indicated, is that there is an isolation between, and there's not a free interchange of information between the three branches of the profession.
So I think you had a question for us. You said there was a question you wanted to ask us, the judges.
This has been a wonderful conference for me to see my former colleagues and my present colleagues. And the bar. I sense that our judges, Andrew, are a little dispirited. Workload, public criticism. And so I ask you this question to the panel. Suppose that there's a vacancy on the district court in your community or the Court of Appeals. And an eminent member of the bar, fine practitioner, comes to you and says, I'm thinking about seeing if I can be considered for selection on this court, to serve on the district court of the Court of Appeals. Can you give me some reasons why I should leave my practice and do that? What would you tell me?
Well, First, I wanted to tell a story about my colleague, Margaret McEwen. When I was going through the confirmation process, which was for 2.25 years, at some point in the middle, I had never met Margaret, but I called her just for advice, for the kind of advice you're talking about. And I said, Margaret, is this all worth it? She said, Marcia, no billable hours. You know, so for that reason, I would tell them there is certainly an advantage. I usually tell people that there is more work than you can possibly imagine. Whenever there are people in the confirmation process and we talk to them, people who are have been nominated for our court, and I think we try to warn them, I don't think it ever gets through until they're actually there. And then there is obviously the rigors of the confirmation process at this point, which is very discouraging to many people. There are the financial considerations. My law clerks, as you all know, walk out the door if they go work for a big firm and make more money than I do the day I walk out. And despite all that, I think we all feel incredibly privileged to be doing what we're doing and probably wouldn't give it up for anything. Nonetheless, there are many people who would not make that choice and don't make that choice.
I think as an Article I judge, one of the things I have to say is we are so benefited by the fact that we don't have to go through the same confirmation process. When a judge retires on my court, the Ninth Circuit will make sure that the new judge is there the next day. And that's been so critical to the success of the bankruptcy system nationally during this time of economic chaos. And I can only wish that my colleagues in the Court of Appeal and Court of Appeals and the District Court had the same certainty that that vacated spot would be filled quickly. For me, billable hours is an issue, but I freely admit that I like working hard. Not having to find your clients is my counterpart to billable hours. They're always there. I don't have to do client development. But the intellectual challenge, the ability to take any issue, no matter how small the amount at issue, that's important, and track it through to the end to the solution that's just and right, and the opportunity to sit there and not always give people good news, but always give it to them fairly and treat them with decency is at the end of the day, I feel good about what I do every single day.
I would offer that the calling to be a judge is both a duty and a privilege. And it's a duty to country, a duty to the preservation of the rule of law. To quote the Talmud, if it's not you, then who? If it's not now, then when? And it's the opportunity to deal and interface and interact with some incredibly gifted colleagues and to handle some very challenging cases and make a difference in people's lives. And again, it's a privilege. I would not do it for the money, but there are other rewards.
Ditto.
So Andrew, are you going to apply to be a district judge next go around?
Well, we're...
We
as lawyers, I mean, we're all here because, you know, we love the institution and those comments are very inspiring, you know, to all of us. I mean, it's moving.
You mentioned bankruptcy judges selection. I was against the idea of having the circuit conference, circuit council choose bankruptcy judges. I thought it would involve us in what's a political function and that your neighbor would come over and say that her cousin was going to be, wanted to be on the court and we'd have to get into this. The Ninth Circuit under Jim Browning decided that at the very outset we'd have committees. And Dorothy Nelson and Cliff Wallace were for their part of the state. I think in Northern California, because we didn't have a district judge from San Francisco at the time, I don't think, and I was, Jim Browning was chief and wasn't involved in it. And Sacramento, so I think, in the first 18 months, we had to appoint something like 15 bankruptcy judges. And I was so impressed about the quality of the people that would come to apply for that because they didn't want to mess with this political process, but they wanted to be judges. It was a real learning experience for me. But there are, the confirmation progress is rigorous, of course, and quite flawed. But I agree with what you've said. I tell the attorneys that the Constitution of the United States is one of the most brilliant documents in the history of human thought. And it's uniquely ours. It's what defines us as Americans. It had a flaw which was only resolved by the Civil War with 600,000 dead, but that makes it all the more priceless. And you have the capacity to teach particularly young Americans, people, what the Constitution and the laws mean in the context of your own times. I might have mentioned at another conference one time that I was a great admirer of Alexander Solzhenitsyn, who wrote one day, among other things, One Day in the Life of Ivan Denisovich, which I think all judges in the criminal process should read. It's about 24 hours in the life of a prisoner in Siberia. And Solzhenitsyn later, in later life, said some and did some strange things. But this was a magnificent novel. And he was given the invitation to speak at the Harvard University Charter Day. And if the trustees of Harvard ask you to speak at Charter Day, they think it's better than the Nobel Prize. You know, they think this is really it. And so he gave this speech, and it was pre-internet, and so I had to wait for a couple days to get the text out of the New York Times. And I was so disappointed that he attacked the West for being obsessed with the law. And he said, any society that defines its existence in legalistic terms is condemned to spiritual mediocrity. And I said, what's this man talking about? And then I realized that for him, law means something different than for us. For him, from his background, from his history, from his country, the law was a ukas, a mandate, a decree, a diktat. It was the assertion of raw power. For us, it's a promise. It's liberating. It gives you your freedom. And that's what judges do.
I want to thank Justice Kennedy and the other panelists, and thank all of you. Let's give it.
Thank you.
Thank you.